Today, we're going to be talking about CSS. I'm getting a lot of comments or emails or questions about CSS, and I thought that I would address some stuff here. I'm noticing a lot of people build stuff, and then they don't know how to make it look the way that they want. And just understanding the foundational aspects of CSS can help you. The point that I'm making is without CSS, a website can look like this. This is Stripe's website with no CSS. And then obviously Stripe, they're one of the best looking sites. Here it is after CSS, really just makes the website seem alive and look really nice. So let's get into how you can actually add custom CSS to a website. First, we need to discuss the three main ways you can add CSS. There's externally, internally, and inline. Externally is the most common way that I make custom CSS, and that's by linking a style sheet in the head of the document. So if you're working with a framework like Astro, you would import it using the link tag and then the path to the CSS file. From there, you can open the CSS file and add whatever CSS you want to your site. Alternatively, there's internal CSS, which is adding style tags within the head and then adding your custom styles right within there. So this is recommended for styles that are going to be above the fold of your website, the critical styles. And the last way to include CSS in your website is inline CSS. And for the most part, in the web development community and in places that I've worked, this is frowned upon. I would advise against inline CSS. It can make things messy. I find myself doing it if I'm just trying to make something work really quickly and I don't want to spend a lot of time on it, but it's a bad habit. Just don't do this. Before we go into selectors and CSS, the only way I think to remember properties with CSS is to actually practice building stuff with them and using a good reference like the MDN web docs. So I'll link this below. This will go through a lot of rules, a lot of the properties and the values associated with them. So you might have a property like margin that takes a set number value like pixels, but then you also might have a property like color. Obviously, that's going to take a color. There's HTML colors, there's hex colors, there's all different types of RGB colors. So I think just the best way to learn the properties and their associated values is to just practice building stuff with them. But you want to use a site like the MDN docs to use as a frame of reference so you know that you're doing it correctly. And what I've done here is just compile a list of selectors. So this type of stuff is what you would put on your external CSS sheet or within the head and the style. These are just a list of selectors that you might use to target specific elements of your page or all the elements of your page based on what you're doing. So let's go through them here. First is the ID. So CSS by ID, you use a hash or a pound sign and then whatever the ID is. So to set an ID within the HTML element itself, you would just use ID equals and then whatever the ID is between quotes. So if I use the example ID red text, it would look just like this here. The next one is by CSS class. So this is if an element has the CSS class of red text, that is denoted by a period in front of the class name. So period red text would be the CSS class. And we can see that written out here with the paragraph tag with a class of red text. Both of these would turn the text red. There is a difference in specificity, which I won't go into, but just know that if you're applying a property somewhere and it doesn't seem to be taking, you probably have a property that's overriding that property. I hope that makes sense. Long story short, an ID is more specific than a class. So in an instance where a element has both an ID and a class, it's going to accept the ID first. Something to be aware of. Next, we're going to apply CSS to a type of element. This will be the body tag. All the things in the body tag will have the color of red for their text. Or you can select all the elements on a page using an asterisk. And here we're setting the margin to 0 on all elements. Next, we go into pseudo classes. So these are selectors that aren't necessarily the elements themselves, but they could be a relative like their first child here. So the first element within the div is going to be the color red. Or we can even select the number value of the child. So here's the div nth child. So this is the third item within the div is going to have a color red. We could also use a descendant selector. So that means all p elements within the div would be color red. Or a child. So this would only apply to children of the first element. So ul, li, all of the LIs that are encapsulated with the UL would have the color red. Next is adjacent sibling selector. So this is the first P directly associated with the H1. And then we have the general sibling selector. So this is all P elements that follow an H1. And that's pretty much most of the selectors that I use. With new CSS additions, they do make nesting and stuff that you used to have a CSS processor for. For the last example, we're going to go over variables within CSS. Again, you used to have to use a processor to, or a preprocessor to compile this type of stuff. Now it's widely available within CSS. You can define CSS variables using colon root. And within here, these are your variables that you're defining. You can define a color or a pixel value or a number value. And then you can apply them using var parentheses. So just like this syntax here. So this would use the background color of the blue here. And we'd have a universal padding with a spacing of 16 pixels. The obvious benefit of this is you can apply these variables throughout your CSS. And if you change your mind on some of the spacing or you change your mind on a base color or main color, you can easily do that in one spot here and it would change throughout the CSS. So I hope this was helpful. I hope you got something out of this video. CSS is something that you can learn pretty quickly. And if you just take this information and you just practice writing CSS and building out pages and on your own, if you look into, okay, how do I do a gradient? How do I do spacing? That's something that we didn't get into, but like grid and flexbox, how do I center a div? That's like a meme at this point. Just look into that stuff yourself. All of that is going to be within the MDN documentation, all the spacing stuff, gradients. All this stuff is here. So you have the tools now to write CSS, the three ways that you can do it, the places you got to put them, the selectors. All you have left to do is go out and build something and try and make it look the way that you want. So I hope this was helpful. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.